In the previous classes, we have learned about Renaissance architecture style starting from early to high Renaissance. Renaissance has been started in Florence as a new architecture style. It is not the slow evolving process in a way that Gothic grew out of Romanism, but is a conscious revival brought to being by particular architects who sought to reuse the orders of past golden era. By using the term golden era, here we mean classical period of Greek and Roman. And they adopted the elements of classical era, that was classical orders, columns, domes, symmetry, square plans, pilasters, pediments. And during the Renaissance architecture style, architects began to look back to the Renaissance and Greek architecture style for inspiration while designing the building, and then altered to fit their own current needs. In this class, we will learn about Mannerism style of architecture. Mannerism style is a sub-style of a Renaissance style and also called late Renaissance. It has been originated in Italy as a reaction against the equilibrium of form and proportion characteristics of the high Renaissance. In the Mannerist style, architects employs classical elements in a new and unusual way that defies traditional formulas that has been used in the high Renaissance. They were using the elements of classical style, but in very usual and common manner. But in Mannerist, they were using the unusual ways to use that elements in the building. And Mannerism comes from the Italian word called Manera, that means mannered or styled. So all the elements that has been used in the building were styled according to architects who were used in an unusual way. The events that led to the evolving or the advent of Mannerist architecture style was the reorientation of trade routes from east to west, so that the whole of the Italy or whole of the Europe was having the wealth. And then there was a threat of Turkish invasions. The Princess was the book published by Machiavelli that says it shows the economic relativity of being good and bad of a person. So it says everything is purchasable, it has a value. So classical calm, harmony, images no longer in a fashion. So they want to experiment. They want to experiment in classical order and the forms. Artists license practices more freely and openly. It was because the text that was available, and many have written the books on architecture. So it has been practiced very freely, and anybody can practice the architecture. Characteristics of Mannerist architecture: stylishness is design, could be applied to a building as well as to painting. So Mannerism is not the style, it has been happened in architecture. It was also applicable to the painting and art of that period. Showed extensive knowledge of Roman architecture style. So they have gained knowledge of the architecture style that was there in the Roman, the elements that has been used. So they started to use their elements in a very new way. Complex out of step style. That is taking liberties with classical architecture. Architecture, sculpture, and walled gardens were seen as complex but not necessary unified whole. So the gardens, the porticos, the walls of gardens were designed in the form of Mannerist style. But it is not necessary the building is in the Mannerist style. So Mannerist characteristics shows the exaggerating elements, distorting elements, breaking rules of arrangement, joking, using obscure classical precedents, over-refining, inventing free composition, abstracting classical forms, suggesting primitiveness, and suggesting incompleteness, suggesting imprisonment, suggesting structural failure. So all the elements were used in a very unusual, joking, and very unique way by the architects. This is the example how abstraction of orders has been used. In this picture, you can see the orders has been placed, but in a very unusual way. They are not the structural part of the building. They are only used as the as a plaster in the building. And some has pediment, and some orders do not have pediment. This is anti-structuralism. The structure system says ki there is the arch that is holding the opening, but it is not. There is a lintel that is holding the openings. You can see in the picture there is a lintel that is holding the openings, not the arch that is supporting the openings. The columns are only used as a decorative purpose and not an structural element. Rustication. Rustication that was there on the corners of the building in high and early Renaissance, it has been used in a very intricate and the very elaborated way on the door openings, on the coins, and other parts of the building. You can see in the picture the rustication of this opening has been very elaborated and exaggerated. The exaggeration and the dismemberment of the elements. Exaggeration of the element, you can see there is an arch, there is pediment, there is arch opening. Above that, there is again an arch opening. The columns with where the column has been ended, another column has been started from that the column from where it is ended. So there is an exaggeration and use of lots of element in one element of a building. Mannerism was marked by widely diverging tendencies in the work of Michelangelo, Romano, Peruzzi, and Andrea Palladio that led to the Baroque style. This Mannerism style, when DJ Stock has led to the style of Romanesque style. An architect born in Siena but working in Rome. Peruzzi worked bridges the High Renaissance and the Mannerist. He had designed Villa Farnesina in 509 in very regular monumental cube of two equal stories, the bay being strongly articulated by orders of pilasters. You can see it has the two-story building in which there are orders, pilasters, and the all elements that was there of High Renaissance, but used in a very unusual way. The use of frescoes on the building is unusual. That characterized this building as a Mannerist building. The another building designed by Spalazzo Massimo. The characteristics of building that made the building that characterized this building as a Mannerist style is the curve, and this building has been curved according to the road which is adjacent to it. It is a three-story building in which there are different types of windows on the three stories. The mystery has been added in the building by making a portico that has been recessed inside that create a dark and mysterious portico rather than a semi-enclosed space. So this adds to the mystery to the building, and sometimes it at the time of construction it acts as a refuge to the poor people of the city. Another Mannerist architect is Giulio Romano. He was a pupil of Raphael, and he had designed Palazzo T, a very famous project at Mantua. In this project, he combined his skill of architect, sculptor, and a painter. In this work, he incorporated garden grottoes, extensive frescoes, illusionist effect of surprising combination of architecture, form, and texture. The frequent use of features that seem somewhat disappropriate or out of alignment. So we will see how the elements has been used in very unusual way and in a very disturbing ways in this building, and which created a total effect of eerie and disturbing. So that is why this building has been characterized as a mannerist building. Palazzo T is a horse form and a villa. Unsetting architectural setting. It unsets the architectural setting. Triglav dips into the, you can see the, triglavs dips into the cornice, creating holes above. This is the hole that has been created above. Pediments corners do not meet. These pediments corners do not meet to each other. Window openings at unconventional locations. So we can see these are the window openings that has been created here, but there is no opening. This is a false opening. But the real opening that is there, it is located in very unconventional location. Engaged columns divided facades into unequal base. So the base that has been created are not equal. They are according to the elements that has been used in the bay, not the regular intervals of the columns that has been placed. Massive columns carry almost no weight. So these columns are very massive, but they do not carry any weight. And then a very narrow cornice. Keystone pops out of the arch. You see this arch and sets into the pediments. Oddly sized stones, they are very oddly sized stones, and all the sizes of all the stones in all the bays were different. High unusual placement of arches. You see this is arches, but below a pediment. You see the arch, but a false arch. The arch and the combination of the pediments creates a very unusual effect. These are the elevations of Palazzo Del T in Mantua by its north, west and east elevation. Another building that has been designed by Romano is its own house in Mantua. So the elements that has been used in his own house are also very unusual. You can see the pediments. The lintel is the supporting elements or the load carrying elements of the window. But again, the use of arches above the pediments is very unusual. The location of windows at very unusual positions. Lintel not above the windows. It is away from the windows. And it is against the structural elements of the building. Arches, but arch again, it's not the load carrying elements. The load of the door or the lintel is carrying the load above the door. Then a pediment. So all these elements again creates a very disturbing elements. Another very famous and important architect of Mannerist style is Michelangelo. He excelled in each of the field of painting, sculpture and architecture, and his achievement brought about significant change in each era. His architectural frame lies chiefly in two buildings, that is the interiors of the Laurentian Library and its lobby at the monasteries of Saint Lorenzo in Florence and Saint Peter Basilica in Rome. St. Peter Basilica was the greatest creation of Renaissance, and a great number of architects contributed their skill to it. But at its completion, there were more of Michelangelo's design than any of the other architect before or after destruction of St. Peter Basilica in Rome. The Pope floated a competition for rebuilding of St. Peter Basilica in Rome. Many architects gave their design, but the plan of Bramante was selected. After that, many other competitions were floated, and many other architects has given the series of design and plans for the St. Peter Basilica. Lastly, Michelangelo, when he took over the project, he redesigned the plan of St. Peter Basilica, considering the plan of Bramante's, that was Greek cross plan, and he redesigned the pyres, the walls and the domes, giving the
lower weight-bearing members, massive proportion, and eliminating the encircling ails from the chancel and the identical transept arms. Michelangelo dome was the masterpiece. He has used double shell dome in the St. Peter Basilica that was used in Florence with ribs. For the exterior of the building, he has used giant orders which divide the building in the form of base and a cornice that runs around the building in the form of ribbon, which holds the building in the form of one entity. This is the aerial view of St. Peter Basilica showing the church and the St. Peter Square.
Basilica. These are the various plans that has been developed for St. Peter Basilica time to time and was selected. The first plan that was selected for designing St. Peter Basilica was the Bramante's plan in 1506 AD. Then Bramante and Raphael designed the plan for St. Peter Basilica. This is the Sanglo plan for St. Peter Basilica. And after that, the plan that on which the construction took place was the plan of Michelangelo in 1546-64 AD. This figure shows the comparison between the Bramante's plan, its dome, and the design that has been generated by Michelangelo for St. Peter Basilica. The dome designed by Michelangelo was double layer, double skin dome. This figure shows a cross section of St. Peter Basilica through nave, bay, and the crossing. Another important building designed by Michelangelo was Laurentian Library. The design that was of Mannerist style was the vestibule of Laurentian Library. The library has the staircase which leads to the upper part of the building, which contains the library. So this vestibule you can see has a staircase which is very unusual. The main staircase, the central one that is leading to the library, it has a steps which is circular, supported by two adjacent staircases which is leading to the wall. The columns which were used in the High Renaissance or the Early Renaissance that was projecting out in the form of pilasters, but Michelangelo used these columns in recess, the huge column fitted into the recess, and they are not the columns, the structural columns, they are not leading the build, leading to the ground. It has been ended in mid between. The windows that has been designed are the blank windows only as the ornamental parts, ornamentation part. The real window has been designed at the lower part of the vestibule. The windows has been painted on the walls in a very unusual way, giving a very mysterious effect.
Andrea Palladio was the most influential architect of the whole Renaissance. He was inspired by the Greek and Roman architecture style, especially Vitruvius. He has written four books on architecture, basically inspired from Vitruvius' books on architecture. His major work was Basilica Palladiana at Vicenzane, where his most of the life spent. Another feature of Andrea Palladio's style was the use of peristyle in his building. May it be palaces or churches, he has used this style in his building, which was the major feature of classical Roman and Greek architecture. And he has used triumphal arches as a motif in his buildings on windows and on arcade. Rather than it was used by Alberti in his church called Saint Andrea, he used that triumphal arch as a facade of the building. But Andrea Palladio used triumphal arch as a motif that represent a window or an arcade of the building. And later it was known as Palladian arch, as you can see in this figure.
You can see in this figure how the triumphal arch motif and triumphal arch elements of the triumphal arch has been used in the arcade of the building in a smaller scale. The best known building designed by Palladio was Villa Carpa or Villa Rotonda. It is a century planned house with a dome central hall and four identical facades, each with a temple-like portico like that of Pantheon in Rome. You can see this is a figure of Villa Rotonda, which has the identical facade on all the four sides. It has a dome representing the dome of the Pantheon with an oculus over it. The facade is also representing the facade of the Pantheon, which has pediment and the columns in a peristyle way. It has been raised on a high plinth to give it a massive structure. Building has four identical facades, each with a different view. Interior has rotunda with four larger rooms alternating with four smaller spaces to allow for more intimate settings. When a building viewed from afar, no matter from what angle, it looks complete. Used as a working from family estate villa retreat. Villa appears as a mini temple, perhaps a residence of the Moses. Ideal nature of central plan evokes the ancients. Symmetrical ground plan, low round Roman arches, not the domes of the Renaissance. Originally, the dome has an oculus like the Pantheon. Now, it is glazed. Building set on a very high podium, pediments dominate doors and the windows. Another very modern building designed by Palladio was St. Giorgio Maggiore in Venice. It has very interesting facades. It has interlocking pediments and columns. You can see there are two facades when you can see the facade of the building. When you see the facade of the building, it has two facades. One is this facade, another is this facade. So all these two facades has been interlocked with each other. It has high pedestal. The columns has high pedestal. More mannerist than the Villa Rotonda. Two temple facades that I've said, they are interlocked with each other. And clearly lit interior of the building. Thank you for listening to the lecture. That is all from Mannerist architecture style. Another lecture will be on Baroque architecture style.